And two advanced mornings, there will be a coffee and pancake morning in Hanbridge Hall, here in Hanbridge Hall, on Thursday the 16th of June from 10 o'clock to 11:30. Pancakes are always good too, okay? And the tickets for that are £2. And also advance notice of the bus trip, which will take place on the 20th of August. And this year it's going back to Fitlochry at House of Brewer. Lunch is at Cafe Beeman, Fitlochry, and the cost of that is £30 per head. And if you haven't already given your names to Mary Bushell and would like to go, please do so. And finally, any personal issues this week to the mass, and the phone number for that is on the back of the order of service. And I'll now ask Annette to lead us in worship this morning.
Thank you. year, and Matthew, we're prize winners. And I said to Charlie, like, next week it would be his turn, and to show this, it would be their turn because it would be the Scouts' Thanksgiving. And Charlie, you were away camping, weren't you? So you missed it. But you know that you were a prize winner, don't you? You won the Squirrel of the Year for the Monday, is that right, Kenny? So there you are. And Shoris, not you this morning, got the most determined squirrel. I don't know if that's good or not, is it? Is that good? Yes, I'm sure it is. So here, congratulations to you. And not only that, you also got an award, a Founders Award, because that first kind of state is the first squirrel trip you've had, isn't it? So there you are. So that's a day of celebration. And when Mrs. Bushnell and I were there with quite a few other invited guests, we were treated to lovely singing. The Scouts always have a good sing song. And some of the songs, there was a song about sticks, rubbing sticks together, a campfire song, so that was good. And there was also, of course, the song that we always kind of, is it Boom Chicka Boom? And it seems to go on forever, Boom Chicka Boom. Those of you who have been Scouts or who have children that have been Scouts, I'm sure they recognise these. So we had a good old sing song. We like to sing. We like to sing in church, of course, and we sing at school, and we sing at parties, and we sing during our organisations. And of course, we like to sing at the football. What were the Liverpool fans singing last night then? Anybody know? No, before they get beat, obviously. You'll never walk alone. So there's a good football song for you. Unfortunately, they didn't win. You'll never walk alone. That's what they were singing. Do you know that song? You want to sing it? Does anybody want to sing? No? No singing today. We'll sing later on. I've got a story actually for you this morning from the Bible, and it's got some singing in it. And it's a really exciting story. It's about two men who are called Paul and Silas, and they're in the city of Philippi. And they come across someone who they try to help. They're praying for people and healing people here. Some of the people that are in the city don't like this. They don't like Silas and Paul being in their city. And so they complain about them. And Paul and Silas get dragged away to jail. They get put in jail. And not only do they get put in jail, they get put in, all their feet are all locked up so that they can't move. And do you know what they're doing? What are they doing in prison? They're not crying and feeling sorry for themselves. They're praying to God and they're singing. And then suddenly, about midnight, there's a big earthquake. And what happens in the prison is that all the doors of the prison are opened. And all the prisoners with all shackles and everything on their feet and their hands, these are all loosened, they're all broken off, and the people are free to walk out of the prison. But they don't. They just stay there, strangely enough. And then the jailer who is the one that has locked Silas and Paul and all the other prisoners up, he comes running out and is terrified because of a very shameful thing if all the prisoners run away and he's the jailer. He would be in a lot of trouble with his big boss. And so he's terrified. He comes running in. And Paul says to him, don't worry, don't harm yourself. We are all here, we're all accounted for, and not one of the prisoners has run away. So that's a very strange thing. And you know, the jailer is so surprised by all this that he says to Paul that he wants to believe in the God that Paul believes in, the God that Paul and Silas have been praying to. And so his life has changed. His life has changed. No longer does he want to be a jailer locking people up, because that's an important job. He wants to be a follower of Jesus. So that's just another great story from the Bible. And the important part for us this morning is that Paul and Silas don't have a care in the world, even though they're in prison, because they believe in a God who loves them and a God that they want to praise them to sing your praises. Hear our prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen. See you next week for a special service. Bye-bye.
The first reading this morning is Psalm 97. It is on page 603. Psalm 97 on page 603. The Lord reigns, let the earth be glad, let the distant shores rejoice, clouds and thick darkness surround him, for righteousness and justice are the foundation of his throne. Fire goes before him and consumes his foes on every side. His lightning lights up the world, the earth seethes and trembles. The mountains melt like wax before the Lord of all the earth. The heavens proclaim his righteousness, and all people see his glory. All who worship images are put to shame. Those who boast in idols worship him, all you gods. Zion hears and rejoices, and the villages of Judah are glad because of your judgments, Lord. For you, Lord, are the Most High over all the earth. You are exalted far above all gods. Let those who love the Lord hate evil, for he guards the lives of his faithful ones and delivers them from the hand of the wicked. Light shines on the righteousness and joy on the upright in heart. Rejoice in the Lord, you who are righteous, and praise his holy name. The next reading is from Acts chapter 16, verses 16 to 34, and it's on page 1112. Paul and Silas in prison. Once when we were going to the place of prayer, we met by a slave girl who had the spirit by which she predicted the future. She earned a great deal of money for her owners by fortune telling. She followed Paul and the rest of us, shouting, "These men are servants of the Most High God who are telling you the way to be saved." This girl kept us up for many days. Finally, Paul became so troubled that he turned around and said to the spirit, "In the name of Jesus Christ, I command you to come out of her." And at that moment, the spirit left her. When the owners of the slave girl realized that their hopes of making money was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace to face the authorities. They brought them before the magistrates and said, "These men, Jews, were thrown our city into an uproar by advocating customs unlawful for us Romans to accept or practice." The crowd joined in the attack against Paul and Silas, and the magistrates ordered them to be stripped and beaten. After they had been severely flogged, they were thrown into prison, and the jailer was commanded to guard them carefully. When he received these orders, he put them in the inner cell and fastened their feet in the stocks. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was such a violent earthquake that the foundations of the prison were shaken. At once, all the prison doors flew open, and everyone's chains came loose. The jailer woke up, and when he saw the prison doors open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself because he thought the prisoners had all escaped. But Paul shouted, "Don't harm yourself, we're all here." The jailer called for lights, rushed in, and fell trembling before Paul and Silas. He then brought them out and asked, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" They replied, "Believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household." Then he spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all the others in his house. At that hour, at the hour of the night, the jailer took them and washed their wounds. Then immediately he and all his household were baptized. The jailer brought them into the house and set a meal before them. He was filled with joy because he had come to believe in God, he and his whole family. Amen.
Fortune-telling slave girl, and we might wonder why he has taken such exception, because listen to what she's saying about him. These men are servants of the Most High God who are telling you the way to be saved. We might wonder, why is Paul so offended? The reason, it seems, is because you've been following them around, constantly shouting this for days on end. And Paul has had enough. This constant shouting has got on his last nerve, and so he is annoyed, and he commands the fortune-telling spirit to come out of the girl. And the result is that she can no longer prophesy and make money for her owners. And so they are not best pleased with Paul and Silas, to put it mildly. They bring Paul and Silas before the magistrates, accusing them of disturbing the peace of the city. But really, that's all nonsense. It's all about the money. And so Paul and Silas are beaten up and thrown in jail. The jailer makes sure that there's absolutely no chance of escape by putting them in an inner cell within the prison and putting their feet in stocks. We can imagine the absolute wretchedness of their situation. First of all, Paul and Silas are innocent men, falsely accused and imprisoned. And they've been beaten up, they're battered and bruised and hungry and cold. Not sure what is going to happen to them next and whether they'll ever see the light of day again. And what are they doing in the middle of all this misery? Well, instead of moaning and complaining, which would be quite natural, we have to say, they are praying and singing hymns to God. We're not sure what they were singing, of course, and probably a psalm, maybe the words from Psalm 97 that John read for us this morning. Light shines on the righteous, and joy on the upright in heart. Rejoice in the Lord, you who are righteous, and praise his holy name. And the other prisoners are listening to the singing, to this praise. They're not protesting or yelling to them to stop the racket. In this terrible place, this terrible prison, above all the cries of pain and agony, suddenly comes the sound of this joyous singing, a sound of hope. So God is already at work here. And then comes a violent earthquake that rattles the very foundations of the prison and causes the doors to fly open and the chains to become loose. Much to the jailer's terror, of course, he thinks the prisoners have escaped and he will be held responsible. And it's not a disciplinary hearing or his P45 that he has to worry about. His failure to do his job will cost him his life, and so he decides to die by his own sword. But before he can do that, Paul calls to him, "Don't harm yourself. We're all here. Everyone is accounted for, a miracle in itself. The other prisoners haven't believed it." And so the jailer looks after Paul and Silas, and he and his household are baptized. Oh, to have the faith of these first apostles. What is it that we sing in our hymn? Faith can sing through days of sorrow. And in the words of the hymn that we'll sing shortly, no storm can shake my inmost calm, while to that rock I'm clinging. Since love is Lord of heaven and earth, how can I keep from singing? As I said to the children, we sing all the time when we've got something to celebrate. Nothing better than a good old knees up. wonderful to be back there again. Last week we celebrated Holy Communion at Hundred Court, and as we were having our wee chats afterwards, the subject got around to what hymns we would pick for our own funeral. Cheery wee conversations we have. One woman said that she wants In the Bleak Midwinter, that lovely hymn by Christina Rossetti. The words, especially, "What can I give him who as I am," have meaning for her. When she told her family what she wanted played at her funeral, they were aghast. In the bleak midwinter? You can't do that. That's a Christmas hymn. What if you die in the summer? That's my best Tuesday accent. When I sit with a family to arrange a funeral, they sometimes already know what hymns they're going to choose, because their loved one has left specific instructions, just like the woman in Conrad Court. But more often than not, they don't know which hymns to pick, especially if they themselves are not church goers. So some families stick to the traditional hymns, "Abide with me," or "The Lord's my shepherd," or "How great thou art." Hymns that maybe they're familiar with because they've heard them sung at funerals that they've attended. Others tell me straight away that they don't want anything too sad, and they would prefer something more uplifting. "Morning has broken and all things bright and beautiful are faded." But usually if a family asks advice, I always suggest "Thine Be the Glory," because it's a great hymn that speaks of resurrection, the victory over death that Jesus has won for every one of us, and how death has lost its sting. Words of faith. Faith that can sing through days of sorrow. And that's the kind of faith that allows Paul and Silas to express such joy amid such pain and suffering and uncertainty. To keep holding on. To believe that there will be a bright tomorrow. That all will be well. To stick with it. And this is what Paul and Silas are doing. They are holding on, sticking with it. Even when they get the chance to escape, they don't. They stay in the prison with the jailer, because right at this moment, his salvation is more important than their freedom. They stay. They stay for as long as it takes. And again, as we've seen over the last few weeks, as we've looked at the Acts of the Apostles, God has orchestrated this whole thing. But not so that Paul and Silas can go free as we might expect. Surely God will look out for these faithful apostles. But actually their salvation is secure. God is concerned for the jailer's soul. Paul and Silas are already free, even in the prison. The jailer is the real prisoner here. The jailer who is busy ordering, who should be busy ordering everybody back to their cells, or at least the very least wondering why they haven't all escaped. But he has only one question. Only one question is in his heart. What must I do to be saved? The jailer is so convinced, not by his singing because he was asleep at that point, but by Paul's compassion and composure. Paul's so obviously at peace with the world around him, even in a prison cell. Paul's serenity lets him see his own life in a new light. And so his question to Paul, "How can I be saved? What do I have to do to get good with Instead, believe. Believe in the one who breaks the power of cancelled sin. Believe in the one who sets the prisoners free. Believe in the one who makes broken hearts rejoice. So God has arranged this whole thing, shaking the very foundations of not only the prison, but of the jailer. This unnamed man, a man who probably in his capacity as a jailer wouldn't have shown Paul and Silas much mercy. And he might seem an unlikely candidate for God's love and mercy and salvation. Not like the other conversion and experiences that we've looked at over recent weeks. Not like Cornelius, the Roman centurion from a few weeks ago, who was known as a righteous man of God. A God-fearing man, we were told. And not like Lydia from last week, the dealer in purple cloth, and already a worshipper of God, who was found by Paul at the place of prayer. And of course the conversion was to the new church, the people of the way, or as they will soon be called, the Christian church. But not so the jailer. This is a man who had imprisoned Paul and Silas. A man who before did not know God, and was so frightened, was so terrified, was so imprisoned by his own fear, and his own sense of shame and failure, that he was about to take his own life, about to harm himself. But this man has now been set free. An unlikely candidate. But actually, aren't each one of us an unlikely candidate? Each one of us has been set free by the amazing grace and the abundant love of God shown in Jesus Christ. Isn't that something to sing about? Amen. Sing our next hymn, and this is the one that I've chosen for my funeral, Marjorie. I've told you this before. Well, it's a slightly, you drop dead in the throat, but this is the one I want. 565, my life flows on in endless song. 565.
Thank you.
us never to take your goodness for granted. And may we never bring you offerings that cost us nothing. Amen. Now our prayer of intercession, our prayer for others. Let's pray. God of love, we bring our brothers and sisters, neighbours and friends, and the people of our community, those we know and those we don't know, into your presence. We rejoice with those who rejoice today, those who have found happiness or love or healing or justice, those whose song is a joyful one. And we weep with those who weep today. We weep today for and with the people of Ukraine who face unimaginable loss and suffering as their cities and homes and families and lives are destroyed by brutal violence. O Lord, bring peace. And we pray for the people of Uvalde in Texas, a place where the sweet song of innocence has been silenced by wicked violence. We pray for the families of the 19 little children and the two teachers who were killed by yet another mass shooting in a school, a place where children should be safe. Lord, we have no words except to ask the question, why is this allowed to keep happening? And so we pray for all who have been bereaved, and for the emergency services and first responders. We pray for those who are sick in mind or body, or spirit, those who suffer from chronic conditions. Give them fresh hope and bring them your comfort. And Lord, we remember today those who are in prison, for all who are deprived of their freedom, whether that be through crime or oppression. And we ask for your will to be done. And we pray for those who are in a prison of their own making, the people who, for whatever the reason, constantly have their guard up, and who push those who would befriend and care for them away. We pray for those who are prisoners of addiction. May they be set free. May they be healed. Lord, we pray for ourselves. Fill us this day, Lord, with the joy of life. Help us to breathe out your song in harmony. That others might hear and listen. Refresh all those who have grown stale in their faith. Give them a new song to sing, that they might feel renewed and excited. Hear our prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen. Before we come to our final hymn this morning, it is our stated annual meeting immediately after. I've tried to condense it, so too long, maybe 15-20 minutes. So please do stay if you can. I know that for whatever reason some of you may have to leave, so I will come to the door and then I'll come back at that time and we'll be set up for the meeting. Really, we're talking about the past year or so, what's happened in the church, and also a wee bit of hope the future might bring. We sing our final hymn, 352, Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing. 352.
Thank you.
and the blessing of God Almighty, our Creator, Redeemer and Sustainer, be with you now and forevermore.